Good morning, friendship. How are you guys doing this morning? Good, good. Sorry, I was not sure if we had a video this morning. We've had some funny ones lately. If you haven't been here, welcome this morning. We're so glad to have you. We just want to open service up with a word of prayer, and then we'll go ahead and get things rolling. Jesus, we just want to thank you right now for being in this room, Father. We want to thank you for residing in our hearts this morning, in our minds, Father. And God, we just pray for further renewal of our minds this morning, Lord. As we hear the word, as we worship you, Father, just transform our hearts, transform our thoughts, our minds, and let us become more like you this morning. And in Jesus' mighty name, we worship you and we give you our all this morning. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name, amen. If you would just stand with me, we're going to go ahead and get things rolling with service. Hallelujah. Who's happy to be here this morning? I know I am. Hallelujah. Who knows that we're friends of God? Out of all of the relationships we have with God, being a friend of God is one of the most beautiful, because we get to have this one-on-one relationship with Him, and He walks with us, He guides us, He teaches us every day. Oh, I am a friend of God. Hey, I am a friend of God. Oh, I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. Oh, I am a friend of God. Hey, I am a friend of God. Oh, I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. One more time, I am a friend. I am a friend of God. Oh, I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. Who am I that you are mindful of me, that you hear me when I groan? Is it true that you are thinking of me? You love me. It's amazing. And who am I that you are mindful of me, that you hear me when I call? Is it true that you are thinking of me? How you love me.
Because the Lord, you have called me free.
Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, God Almighty, He's Lord of the Lord. You have called me great. God Almighty, He's Lord of the Lord.
God, we thank you for the friendship that we get to have with you, Lord. Jesus, the relationship that you walk with us, you guide us, you teach us, you show us, Father. We're so grateful, Father. You are such a good God for being exactly who you are, Lord. And even if all the things that we ask for, all the things that we beg you for don't come true, you are still enough just being you, just for giving us breath in our lungs, Father. And Jesus, we're just going to turn that breath right around this morning and give it back to you. As we sing, as we rejoice, Father, we just want to worship you this morning. And God, we just sing that you are great. Your mercy endures forever. You are so great. You are so holy, and you are so worthy of our praise. We just worship you this morning, Lord. And we sing, great are you, Lord. Oh, oh, great are you, Lord. You give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. And great are you, Lord. It's your breath. To you only.
give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken.
Father, God, we just seek to follow you this morning, Jesus.
Oh. It was my cross you bore, so I could live in the freedom you died for. And now my life is yours. Forevermore. And
Yeah.
think of the things that he's done right now in your life. Make it personal for you. The things that he's done that's made him worthy over your life. The things that he's done in your life. The person that he is in your life that makes him Lord over your life. And let's just sing that. Worthy is your name. Oh, worthy is your name. Worthy is your name. You this morning, God. We thank you for who you are. We thank you for what you do and how you move in our lives, God, even behind the scenes when we don't know, even when we don't feel like you're moving. Father, we thank you. You are worthy of all of our praise. You are worthy of all of the honor given to your name. And God, we just declare that you are worthy, you are holy, you are righteous, you are perfect in every way this morning, Father. And we bless your name. And in Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. You guys can go ahead and be seated. We're going to go ahead and do some announcements. We're missing our lovely Miss Lisa this morning. She is away. She won a pool. I want to say a tournament, and they're on to championships. I want to say. I don't know. She's doing great things. She's rocking it. So we miss you this morning, Lisa. But we're just going to go ahead and run through announcements real quick. We are still in our sermon series, The Father Heart of God. And we do have, it looks like, a God Space meeting. It's Sunday mornings at 9 a.m. It started this morning, and it's about being equipped to share the gospel in a shifting world. So if that's something you'd like to be a part of, talk to Pastor Tim after service, and I'm sure he can get you plugged in. And some of our upcoming events that we have, our baptism Sunday date was changed. It's going to be May 29th at 10:30 a.m. If you would like to be baptized, you can talk to Pastor Tim after service today. There's also an insert in your pamphlet that you got this morning, and we just ask that you take a look at that. And if you'd like to be baptized, we would absolutely love to talk to you about that further. And after baptism, we're going to have a little fellowship dinner, and we're asking you guys to bring some side dishes. It's going to be so awesome, so wonderful, and I know y'all got some good recipes, so whip out your best recipe, and you can sign up to bring a side dish out in the lobby today. We've got some sign-up sheets. And then we do have our bi-monthly men's dinner. It's going to be Monday, May 30th at 6 p.m. We would love to see you guys there. It's going to be wonderful, yummy food. You can't miss out there. And then starting in June, we've got our mission of the month. It's going to be community hot meals. And you can also see your bulletin. There's going to be an insert to pick a day to serve. So we would love to have you guys at all of our upcoming events. God is moving in our church. We are so grateful and so just absolutely honored that God moves and still uses us, amen, in this crazy world. And my last thing we've got to say is we've got some ways to give this morning. If you would like to give, you can obviously give in our offering plate. You can give on our website, which is www.fccedgewater.com, or you can text to give. That's the easiest, most fun way. You just text that little number. If you want to add a few hundred zeros on there, we would be eternally grateful. But that is all I've got for you this morning. And Pastor Tim, you are up.
Everyone has to be a Weisenheimer, huh? Well, how are you this morning? Good to see you here. Well, let's all stand. Find one or two people you don't know. Go out of your way to say hello. Don't harass them. But at least find out, if you don't know their name, find out who they are and say good morning. Glad to have you here. Would you do that? That's great. Thank you so much. Weisenheimer. Actually, I think there's a high school teacher, Edison Rich. I think that's her last name. My grandson was there. He said, don't. Well, that's good. Find your way back, if you would, to your seats. I know we've been talking about baptism for a couple of weeks, but I need to talk about it because if I don't, the day will come up on us and we'll say, oh no, I forgot. So take that sheet out of your program for a moment and look at it. If you've worked on it already and filled out your three answers, I can't baptize you until I get to talk to you, because we don't just dunk people here. We talk to them about, is there really a life change? And if there is, then you're a follower of Christ, and that's important. Otherwise, all across the world, people just get wet at their baptisms. It's no real significance in their life, but it is a significant point, pointing out that you belong to Christ, that you're His, and you're a serious follower of His. So I encourage you, if you say, yes, I'd like to be baptized, no matter who you are, no matter if you talk to me or not, I need to see you up front here. Next week is the final week I can talk to you, because the following week is the baptism. So I want to start getting some of this solidified, okay? So make sure you, let's take care of that. That's an important thing to do. Well, good to see you. Let's pray together, shall we? I'm glad you're here this morning. Holy Spirit, you are welcome in this place. We know it's the place of our hearts and our minds. We are the temple of the Holy Spirit. So Holy Spirit, we welcome you to do in our hearts and minds whatever you want to do. Can you tell the Lord that right now? Lord, whatever you want to do in my heart and this morning, I want you to do that. Whatever you want to do. Father, we welcome you to do a work in us so you can do a work through us. In our families, in our workplaces, in our community. That we would be the salt and light you want us to be. Your salt and your light. So we praise you for your presence here today, and we welcome you to do a work in our hearts. To build your church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against your church. As we worship you in our giving, we thank you for meeting our needs. Lord, continue to work that we'd be able to do more for your kingdom. More for your kingdom, Lord. And we praise you in Jesus' name. Thank you, Bree and Josh. Thank you both. Appreciate you. More than you know. More than you know. What I love is I love authentic worship, and I'm around in different places sometimes, and I see things that I say, Lord, give us authenticity. Give us the realness of what is real, not some performance, not some just song, but give us something that is heartfelt to the Spirit of God. That's what we want. Thank you, guys. So to look at our message notes, if you want to pull it out of your program, half page, we're talking about the Father Heart of God. And one of the books I've been reading in this series is by Rebecca McLaughlin, who's a theologian. And she writes this in the front of one of her books. She says, in 1971, Beatles star John Lennon had a dream. Closing his eyes to the atheist regimes of his day, he dreamed of a brotherhood of man with no heaven, no hell, no possessions, no countries, nothing to kill or die for, and no religion. The dream persists. Imagine the song was sung reverentially at the opening ceremony of the 1996, 2006, 2012, 2018, 2020, 2022 in China. All those Olympics the song Imagine was sung. Despite all of this, it is an anthem of unity across the world, but a sad one. At the time John Lennon dreamed this in the 1970s, another set of prophets spoke. Sociologists of religion foretold that global modernization would drive secularization to grow. As the world became more educated, more advanced, more scientific, religious beliefs would retreat. Now, you know, I don't believe in religion, I believe in relationship. Okay, so I want you to get that, okay, because she uses the word religion here. She says, there was only one problem with this so-called secularization hypothesis. I've got some ringing here. She said, it failed. And then she points out where Christianity is growing. It may not be growing in certain places that we think of, but it is growing in many, many places across the world. And she writes here, experts believe that China could have more Christians than the U.S. by 2030, which is only 7 years, 7.5 years from now, and that it will be probably the majority Christian country by 2050 in a land where Jesus is not to be talked about. Isn't that amazing? By 2050. So I looked on my lyrics on this, and the song starts out, "Imagine there's no heaven." And I think, I'm not mad about this song. I think, how sad. Imagine saying goodbye to someone you love dearly, knowing it's over, and it's over completely. I tell you, some funerals I do are very hard to do. And if there was no heaven for those I'm close to, I'd break down. I couldn't do it. Imagine there's no heaven. It's easy if you try. That's one of the problems, is that it is easy if you get gobbled up by the things around you to lose focus on the eternal. No hell below us, above us, only sky. Imagine all the people living for today. And I look at that and I say, Lord, this is so sad. If I'm just left to myself, I wrote this out. If I'm just left to myself to work out all my life struggles and all the heartaches of life, if I'm left just to my own resources, trying to control and change things, imagine if there was no Father God, no loving Father, only us humans solving all the problems in the world. It doesn't work, does it? It just doesn't work. So we've been talking about this for a few weeks now, the Father Heart of God, and in one of our groups we've been going through the Old Testament. We were in Joel this past Thursday, and a couple of these verses hit me hard this week. Joel writes this in Joel chapter 2. He's the prophet of God to Judah, and Judah has forsaken God, and Judah's about to be destroyed. And so he says, blow the trumpet in Zion. This was the trumpet to warn people that the enemy was coming. The enemy's here. Blow the trumpet in Zion. Now the problem is, some Christians take that and they start to get in your face. That's not what we're to do. We're to get God so working in us that God can work through us. We have to repeat this all the time, because if God's not working in me and it's just my flesh or my emotions, now I'm part of the problem, not part of the solution, right? Blow the trumpet in Zion, sound the alarm on my holy hill. Let all who live in the land tremble, for the day of the Lord is coming. By the way, if you're close to God, the day of the Lord in the New Testament is talking about after the time Jesus rose into heaven on Pentecost, the day of the Lord started then. We are living in the day of the Lord right now. This is something that we are to be looking forward to, him coming back and looking forward to meeting him. We're not to get so attached to this world that we want to stay on this world forever. We want to be with him. Okay, we want his kingdom. For the day of the Lord is coming, it is close at hand. Even now, declares the Lord, return to me with what? All your heart, with fasting and weeping and mourning. Okay, so what are we mourning about? We're mourning about our own selves, first of all. God, blessed are those who mourn over their sin, for they will be comforted. Matthew 5, Sermon on the Mount. And then it continues. He says, rend your heart and not your garments. Because in the Old Testament, they'd rip their garments. He says, rip your heart. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and compassionate. He wants to love on you. He wants to love on me. He's gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in love. Abounding in love. And he relents from sending calamity. Well, the day of the Lord's coming soon, and there's probably going to be calamitous times ahead for many of us. And he says, I love you. Tear your heart, not your garment. Get close to me. Follow me. And then he says, let the priests who minister before the Lord weep before the portico and the altar. Let them say, now they need to be weeping, they need to be brokenhearted. These are supposed to be God's messengers. Spare your people, Lord. Do not make your inheritance an object of scorn, a byword among the nations. Why should they say among the peoples, where is their God? Where is God at work in our homes, in our marriages, in our kids, in our grandkids? Where is God at work in our community, at work where you work, in our schools? Where is God at work? He's working. God is working. He's working all the time, and he wants you and I to recognize that and be letting him change us so that he can work through us. So with that in mind, at the top of your notes, we've been using this verse in this series from Jeremiah the prophet. The Lord appeared to us in the past saying, I have loved you with an everlasting love. I have drawn you with unfailing kindness. He pulls us to himself. He never fails. Now, how many times do you find yourself talking to God about the fact he never fails? I find myself talking to him a lot because I am a failure without God. My failures are not final. My failures do not define me because I have a faithful God. My failures do not define me. My failures are not my future. Why? Because I have a faithful God. You with me? Because sometimes we wallow in this failure. So he's the everlasting God. And so I put down some verses here from the Gospel of John. Jesus answered, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. You want the life? Well, don't side with John Lennon on this one. Imagine there's no heaven. He's the life. He's the truth. He's the way. No one comes to the Father. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really know me, you will know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. He's talking to his disciples and saying, if you've seen God, you've seen me. If you know me, you know God. When you say, I want to know God, well, as we get to know Jesus, we get to know God. So we cry out to Jesus. We cry out to the Father, and he is one the same. And I will do whatever you ask in my name so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. He will do it. He will work and change us. And then John 17 says, now this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. This word know, go back to it for a minute, is a Greek verb tense of a continuing tense. And it means a growing experience, a growing relationship. Now this is eternal life, that they know you, that they are in a growing experience, a growing relationship with God. That's knowing God. It's not knowing information about God. It's knowing God in relationship that is growing. So when a person says, I received Christ 45 years ago, and they have no evidence of following Jesus, they have not been truly born again into his family. Okay, that's just how it is. It's a growing thing. So he says, Righteous Father, though the world does not know you, I know you, and they know that you have sent me. I have made you known to them and will continue to make you known in order that the love you have for me, get this, the love you have for me, Father, may be in them and that I myself may be in them. So that love that we've been talking about, the Father's heart of God, we who follow Christ and who have Christ, even with all our failure and even with all our messes, we have that love of God potential to be lived in us and be lived through us. And we must surrender to that. Again, one of my verses I use all the time. Perfect love casts out fear, for fear has torment. We say, why do you have to use these verses all the time? Because that's my foundation. I can't live the Christian life without God's Spirit taking the Word of God and making it real in my heart. Otherwise, I am just going to mess the whole thing up. I can't do it. I love this. Talk about a couple things this morning. Knowing God our Father is our ultimate need. Our ultimate need, knowing Him in a continuous growing way, in a continuous growing relationship. Again, Jeremiah the prophet, Jeremiah 9 says, this is what the Lord declares. Dead bodies will lie down like dung in the open field, like grain behind the reaper, with no one to gather them. This is what the Lord says. Let not the wise boast of their wisdom, or the strong boast of their strength, or the rich boast of their riches. If I'm going to boast about anything, it's going to boast about how much God loves me. And that because He loves me, I can invite Him in my life, and I can be in a knowing relationship that's growing. A knowing, continuing, growing relationship. That's to be the desire of my heart and your heart, to direct my heart in that way. Is the greatest glory, is the greatest gift, is the greatest pleasure. So this quote from St. Augustine, you have made us for yourself, O Lord, and our hearts are restless until they rest in you. Say this one with me, will you? You have made us for yourself, O Lord, and our hearts are restless. Now, how many of us have proved that because we have times when we are so not resting in God? Okay, I've proved it, right? And if you read the life of St. Augustine and you read the life of different people throughout history, how they were so filled with turmoil, so filled with trying to live the Christian life, and they couldn't do it. And so frustrated because they were trying to follow God and they couldn't ever do it. And you can't and I can't. Learn to rest in Him. So I was reading this one story from Philip Keller, who wrote the famous book On the Shepherd. And he says this, a poor peasant lady was walking down the road many years ago, too poor even to own a donkey or even buy a bicycle. She had to trudge back and forth from her house to town on foot. Struggling home one day with a large bag of food over her shoulder, she was overtaken by a friendly farmer in his horse-drawn cart. He stopped and asked her if she'd like a ride. She was elated because her burden had become so hot and heavy. He helped her climb up into the cart beside him, and they were off down the road. He was puzzled because the dear old lady sat with her heavy load slung over her shoulder in his cart. Very gently he said to her, dear lady, why don't you put down your load? Her immediate reply was, oh, don't you know, I want to do my part as well. I read this story and I said, I gotta use it. So I'm like, God, I have to bear this burden alone. I made my bed, I have to sleep in it. I made the stupid choice and I'm going to let it ruin my whole week. I made this terrible decision and I'm going to let it destroy my whole life. I deserve a destroyed week. I deserve a destroyed day. No! Philip Keller says, many of us smile at this story, but we do the same identical thing toward our Father God. We come to Him with our cares and our worries and our concerns and our burdens, and our Father God offers to carry them in His great love and strength, but we adamantly refuse to lay both ourselves or our burdens into His strong arms. Instead, we insist on carrying the load. We are convinced we must do our part in worrying and fretting and struggling with them. It has been well said, if you are still busy worrying, then obviously you have not truly prayed. If you're still worried, how long does it take for you and me to get in that calm position of not worrying anymore? A while sometimes, doesn't it? And we need to persevere into the presence of God and not just give God a 30-second timer. Yeah. It's not a microwave deal. There's some things that has to be cooked, and sometimes it takes some time to get this through to our hearts. So the root of our restlessness is my focus, and I get the same problem sometimes, my focus on the possibilities and opportunities. I don't want to blow that opportunity. I want to see this work, right? My focus on the possibilities and opportunities, instead of being on God Himself, my focus, it's on those things, on the what ifs, bringing anxiety and fear. Have you ever been around someone who's always living in the what ifs? Drives you and me insane, because sometimes it's us. Sometimes it's us, and we don't want to admit it. Sometimes we're living in the what ifs. Did you have a what if kind of week? What if? What if? Guaranteed, it wasn't a fun week. We're to put our focus on God Himself. Here's the truth. Once we know that our main business is to know God, most of life's problems fall into place. What's our main business? To what? To know God. To know God. To lean on Him. So, in Knowing God by J.A. Packer, he writes this about Elizabeth Elliot. He says, she was, of course, the famous missionary widow. Her husband was martyred in Ecuador many years ago. She was confident of God's guidance, sending her back to a tribe in Ecuador so she could reduce their language to writing so the Bible might be translated for this group in Ecuador. The only person who could help her was a Spanish-speaking Christian who lived in the tribe, but within a month he was shot to death in an argument. Woo. She struggled on trying to translate with virtually no help for 8 months more. Then she had to move to another field. She left all her files on linguistic material with her colleagues so they could carry on where she left off. Within 2 weeks, she heard that the file had been stolen. No copy existed. All her work and time and effort was wasted. That, humanly speaking, was the end of the story. Elizabeth Elliot writes this. I simply had to bow in the knowledge that God had His own interpreter. We must allow God to do what He wants to do. And if you're thinking that you know the will of God for your life and you are anxious to do that, you're probably in for a very rude awakening. Get this sentence. You're probably in for a rude awakening if you think you know the will of God in your life all the time. You're in for a rude awakening, and boy, nobody knows the will of God for his entire life. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet, a light unto my path. Some of us know that verse from the time we were little. But that distance is not usually ever years or years or months. It's like a flashlight beam. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet today. I'm walking with God today. Give us this daily bread today. I'm walking in God's will today, right? So, this is what Jerry Packer wrote. He said, sooner or later, God's guidance, which brings us out of darkness into light, will also bring us out of light into darkness. None of us like this. Because it's in the dark times that we're going to latch on to God in desperation, and we're going to cry out to God, and we're going to grow closer to Him in those moments of desperation. So say this one with me out loud. Would you ready? Sooner or later, God's guidance, which brings us out of darkness into light, will also bring us out of light into darkness. It is part of the way of the cross. Not what I really want to do. He wrote the book Knowing God. That's J.I. Packer. Some of us have read that book. So I just finished a book called Brazen. And the title of it is Brazen, Be a Voice, Not an Echo, by Sean Foyt, okay? Worship leader out of California. And he believes that God wants him to to become a politician. He's a worship leader in a huge church. And he believes God's calling him to get elected to the House of Representatives in Northern California. And so he puts his all into this. He's doing this. He's working hard. And he's convinced God's called him to do it. And it doesn't work out. He says here, the room was full of family and friends and strangers. One of the most deflating moments of my life. The cheers of victory never came. Defeat was thick in the air. My usual optimism disintegrated. I felt hollow. Within a few moments, I found out I was in third place behind thousands and thousands of votes. My fears were solidified. The voices of everyone who had mocked and criticized us grew louder in my mind. The distance and absence of many of my friends became more magnified. I had wasted 8 long months. I read the story of Elizabeth Elliot. She said 8 months, and I thought this was strange, and he's saying the same thing. I wasted 8 months of my life. It was like hope deferred that I had never, ever felt before. So what did I do? I pretended to smile as much as I did that night, saying hello and goodbye to supporters and friends and staff. I tried to hold myself together as I drove home. It was a quiet, lonely drive. The next 24 hours were absolutely brutal. I didn't want to get out of bed the following morning. The last time I felt that way was when my dad had died. There was no silver lining here. Nothing brought me comfort or solace. And here's a guy who really walks with God. Serious relationship with God. I just felt utter failure, shame, and embarrassment. Not only that, but for the first time in a long time, I questioned my ability to hear God. You ever question your ability to hear God? So out of this darkness, he's going to go back to what it says on the screen. Sooner or later, God's guidance, which brings us out of the darkness into light, will also bring us out of light into darkness. It's part of the way of the cross. We don't like to hear that. We want every day to be cheerful and sunlight and no rain and no storms, right? But it's through the times of storms that we do our most growing. You ever notice when life's going pretty easy, you tend to get lazy in your relationship with God? You ever notice when it starts to get dark that you start to get a little more intense going back to God? You ever notice that? How come we're that way? I use my word, me. I'm a doofus. What about you? That's just plain old doofusness, okay? No, it's not a word. You're not supposed to say that, okay? Don't you know I make up my own words? My wife's here today and she's saying, Tim, you did it again. I know. It's just my spiritual gift, okay? So look at these couple of verses from Isaiah the prophet. But Zion says, the Lord has forsaken me. The Lord has forgotten me. Sometimes we're there. We feel that way, right? Can a mother forget the baby at her breast and have no compassion on the child she has born? Though she may forget, he says what? Last line, I will not forget you. How many times we need to remind ourselves, I'm surrendering to God. I'm not going to be like the lady sitting in that little trotting cart with the farmer, holding on to my big bag of food, when I can just let it down and let God take me along. Cast my burdens on the Lord. He will sustain me. He will never suffer the righteous to fail. See, not fail. Wait a minute. Let me go back to the word fail. What we think is failure, like this guy, Sean Voigt, he thought failure. I put everything I had, my whole life, into running for the House of Representatives, and I lost. Elizabeth Elliott goes back to the jungles of Ecuador. I put all I could for 8 months into making that translation, and nothing happened. Sometimes that's what happens, because God says, I'm going to do something else in your life that you don't see. You don't see it, but I'm going to do it. I'm going to do something greater in your life than what you think is the most important thing. I've got something greater to do. Are you with me? Does God have the right to do that? Does he have the right to take and shift what you think is most? How many of us have realized as we've gotten older, we have thought certain things were so important, and after this thing was done, we said, why did I put so much stupid time into thinking that was important? I'm the only one here who's a total doofus. No, we got doofusness. All right. That's good. See, I've engraved you on the palms of my hand. Your walls are ever before me. God's in control. God's in control. A week later, his disciples in the house again, Jesus, John, Gospel of John here, John chapter 20. Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. Remember, he comes in, the doors are locked, he's walking through the wall. You know why he said, peace be with you? Come on. You're there and all of a sudden he walks through the wall. We would say, don't freak out. Don't freak out. Okay. And he said to Thomas, put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put them into my side. Stop doubting and believe. Thomas said to him, my Lord and my God. We need those my Lord and my God times to say, okay, I can't feel you. I can't see you. I'm going to believe even though I can't do what Thomas did. I'm going to follow you, God, because you're faithful. Knowing our Father God is our ultimate need. Knowing him in a growing relationship. Second point here, knowing God our Father is our ultimate peace. Our ultimate peace. Again, in the Gospel of John, John 14. All of this I've spoken while I was still with you, Jesus says. But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I've said to you. How many of us need reminders? Okay. Constantly need. Why? Because he's my teacher. He's the one who reminds me. He's the one that turns the light on when everything looks dark. He's the illuminator. The Holy Spirit is. He says, peace I live with you, my peace I give you. I do not give you as the world gives. The world's kind of peace is so temporary. It doesn't last in the middle of the storms. It goes out. We need the peace of the Holy Spirit in us. He's the Spirit of peace. He's the Spirit of love. I do not give you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled and do not be afraid. I have told you these things so that in me you will have what? He's telling you this morning, what areas of turmoil and stress and anxiety are you going through that you need to go to God with today? And stop living in that idea that you can carry the heavy load in the cart. Give the heavy load to the Holy Spirit. Give it to God. In this world, you will have what? Sometimes I say double trouble. Right? In this world, you will have trouble. Oh, I don't like that verse, but I'm sorry, it's there. You will have trouble, but take heart. I have overcome the world. I have overcome the world. For those who are led, Romans Paul writes, for those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. The Spirit you receive does not make you slaves so that you live in fear again. Get this. We've been talking about this song. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I'm no longer a slave to shame. I'm no longer a slave to guilt. We've been going through those in the last 3 weeks, right? I'm no longer a slave to those things. He says, The Holy Spirit you received does not make you slaves so that you live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you received brought about your adoption to sonship, and by him we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. So I walk in this relationship with God, and I get his peace, I get his rest. Some of you know that this is one of my life verses, starting at probably age 14 in Isaiah 26. You will keep him in perfect peace, those whose minds are steadfast because they trust in you. Say this one with me, would you? This is a little different version than the one I learned. First, go back. Ready? You will keep? You will keep in perfect peace those whose minds are steadfast because they trust. I actually like the King James better. Thou will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee because he trusts in thee. Thou will keep him in perfect peace whose mind stays, he uses the word steadfast. I steadfastly stay connected to him in the middle of the turmoil, in the middle of the anxieties, in the middle of the fears, in the middle of the reversals, in the middle of, in fact, that book I read you about the guy in Northern California running to be the House of Representatives, his whole chapter in that book was titled Defeat. Said, what a title for a chapter. Defeat. And yet out of defeat, he's one of the most young, powerful men of God that I've seen being used in our country, all over the world, not just in America, because he is not willing to just settle for sitting down and watching TV all day. But he's actively praying, staying connected to God, and God's using him across the world to influence thousands of people. But sometimes we have defeat and we say, it's not working, it's not working, it's not working. Okay, my heart and my mind are going to be stayed on you because you are the one who gives me your peace. You will keep me in perfect peace. He says, trust in the Lord forever, for the Lord himself is the what? The rock eternal. I have an eternal rock. I don't have to live in the world, again, of John Lennon in 1971, where he writes, imagine there's no heaven. No, I have a God. I have a real God. I have a real Savior. I love to hear how people move out of different things in atheism and agnosticism and how God begins to open their eyes to the gospel. No one's hopeless. He's moving and he's working in your life and in my life. You say, but my life is too full of worry and fear. Okay, that is a signal to get closer to God than you've ever pursued God before, to pursue him more. Yes, Lord, walking in the way of your laws, we wait for you. This is a problem. We wait on God. Stay with me. We wait on God. Your name and renown are the desire of our hearts. We wait for you. We wait on you. We spend time being quiet. You ever around a person who talks so much you never get to say it a word edgewise? I drove one time from New York to Chicago with this pastor. It was like 16 hours to Chicago. I got to talk maybe 20 minutes. I got out of the car like, I don't know if he invited me to any more trips, but I never went on with him on a trip again. I said, 16 straight hours. The guy was in, he just couldn't get tired of talking. But when it comes to talking to God, sometimes we're doing all the talking and say, now God, I'm going to be quiet and let you talk. I got 3 minutes. And we've been talking to God all day long, but we don't stay in his presence, or we don't open the word and say, God, speak to me through your word. Well, God, speak to my heart. Help me to get still. I'm too agitated. I'm too full of turmoil. I'm too full of anxiety. Help me to rest in you, the Holy Spirit, like that farm horse and wagon. Help me to lay my burdens down on you and get you to work in my heart and my life. Your peace, your kingdom, Lord, that's what I want. And so we read again in Joel, do not be afraid, land of Judah. Be glad and rejoice. Surely the Lord has done great things. It doesn't look like it if you looked at what's happening, but God is the Heavenly Father. He's great. Then you will know that I am in Israel, that I am the Lord your God, that there is none other. Never again will my people be what? Shamed. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I'm no longer a slave to guilt. I'm no longer a slave to shame. Because he is my forgiving, loving Savior. So knowing God our Father brings this ultimate peace. And when Joel's talking, he's telling that God's people, despite all the terrible horrors, God is promising them restoration. He tells them to be glad and rejoice. I'm in control. So, knowing God our Father is our ultimate peace. Now, when I was doing this message, a hymn came in my head. Sorry. When you prick me, I bleed. Sometimes I bleed Yankees. I never bleed Red Sox. That's a different kind of bleeding. Okay. But if you prick me, a lot of times I will bleed songs or hymns. And a lot of times it's like all night long. How many of you have that in your head all night long? Right? Okay, that's me. Okay. She said, I knew that guy was insane. I kept on telling you, don't go to that church. That guy's insane. Okay. So this song was written, and some of us know it. This is my Father's world. This is the third verse. This is my Father's world. Oh, let me ne'er forget. Let me never forget. That though the wrong seems oh so strong, God is the ruler yet. This is my Father's world. The battle is not done. You say, oh, I'm tired of fighting. Let's come to the Holy Spirit and let's rest in Him and let Him work in us and through us, not us trying hard. We must cooperate, we must surrender, but it is not us trying hard, it is us surrendering and cooperating with the Holy Spirit. So he says, this is my Father's world, the battle is not done. Are we in a battle? Yes. Are we in a battle? Yes. You say, I don't know what you're talking about. One of our dear people in one of our Bible studies one day came up to me and she said, Pastor Tim, I don't know why you're always talking about these battles and struggles. She looked at me like, you're the biggest loser pastor I've ever had. And I said, well, because we're in a battle. And she couldn't get it. And she moved away to another state, and then I heard one day that she didn't believe in God anymore and she wasn't following God. And she wasn't in the battle because she wasn't in the spiritual realm of becoming a child of God. She had religion. She didn't have Christ. Do you know that when you disturb a hornet's nest, usually there's a reaction by the hornets? Right? You know, if you've ever done that, that there's usually an action that results in, if you can run, you run. Okay? And I'm just telling you, when you're following God, Satan tries to focus his eyes on those who are following God to launch his assault of a whole bunch of hornets. Okay? It's my Father's world. The battle's not done. Jesus who died will be satisfied and earth and heaven be one. He's going to work it out. He's going to work it out. He's already got the victory. So number three, last thought here this morning. To know God our Father, our ultimate pursuit. A couple of verses from David. David said in Psalm 42, as the deer pants for streams of water. I've heard people preach on this over the years. As the deer is being hunted, running through the woods, looking for a brook. The deer's searching. Its energy about give up to the hunter, whether it's a wolf or whether it's a person with a bow and arrow. He finds the water brook. As the deer pants for the water, for the streams of water, so my soul pants for you, my God. I need your water. I need you, God. I need you. I cannot do it myself. He also wrote in Psalm 63:1, you, God, are my God. Earnestly I seek you. Notice he didn't say, you, God, are my God. Sleepily I seek you. It's okay to go to sleep talking to God. That's great. But if you only do it that way, if you do that in your marriage, you have a problem. You have a problem. That's the only time you talk is when a person is half asleep, and then you find out the next day. Us husbands never do this, but I'm just saying that you only heard 1/8 of the conversation, and that's what, go to Publix and pick up a loaf of bread and you miss the other 7 items. We won't raise our hands on that one. You God are my God. My God, earnestly I seek you. I thirst for you. My whole being longs for you in a dry and parched land where there is no water. You're the source of living water. I'm going to skip those verses in Exodus and go to 2 Corinthians 3, where Paul writes these words. He says, even to this day when Moses is read, a veil covers their hearts. Talking about Israel. They're blind. They can't see. He's writing to the church of Corinth. But when anyone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. When we turn to the Lord, what was dark and what was unexplainable, God begins to turn the light on. He is light. When we turn to God, when Israel turns to God, Israel sees that he's the Messiah. When we turn to God, we see he's the answer. We tried all these other things, trying to work it out ourselves, and God says, I'm the one that can work this out. You say, well, I'm trying. I'm trying to help my kids. I'm trying to help my grandkids. I'm trying to help my people at my job come to Christ. I have to surrender it to God and say, God, you're the one who's going to take my life and work in me so you can work through me. Now, the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's freedom. And we all, who with unveiled faces contemplate the Lord's glory, are being transformed into his image with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. He's changing our lives. Is he changing your life? Are you seeing more and more things clearly that God's at work and he's in power, he's in control? And then one last portion here from Philippians 3, Paul writes, but whatever were gains to me, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What's most important to you this morning? Is it your relationship with Jesus Christ to be a growing relationship? Because a lot of times we get too many things in the way. And he sort of gets bumped out of the way. Do you remember those days when you used to drive bumper cars and try to crash into people and bump them out of the way? A lot of times that's almost like our spiritual lives is we're getting bumped all over the place and we're off kilter. He says, what is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus. So that's the first thing. That's the main thing. And I want to keep the main thing the main thing. I need that help, Lord. Holy Spirit, you're the one who helps me. The surpassing worth of knowing Jesus, my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things, and he has. His reputation, they look upon him as being the scum of the earth. His wealth is all gone. If you saw Paul, there were times he talked about walking around in rags. There were times, you know how many times we see him walking around beaten to a pulp, right? Okay, so he's lost all things, and people, then he goes to the church of Corinth, remember, and they say he's an imposter, he's not a real apostle, and they start to rag on him. What a life! He says, loss of all things, I consider them garbage that I may gain Christ. Have you lost that zeal? And you say, I need that back. I need that focus back. Let's get it back, folks. Let's get that focus. Since I turned my eyes on Jesus, I've lost sight of all beside. So enchain my spirit's vision looking at the crucified. I need that vision back. He says, I want to know Christ. Yes, to know the power of the resurrection and participation in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death. So when we're talking about the Father heart of God, today we started talking about the song Imagine. And I wanted to close one more time with the song This Is My Father's World and have you stand with me. Wouldn't you? Stand with me for a minute and let's say this together. Yeah, I'm not going to make you sing it because I don't do that kind of stuff except once a month to irritate you. So let's say it together. Ready? This is my Father's world. Oh, let me ne'er forget that though the wrong seems oft so strong, God is the ruler yet. This is my Father's world. The battle is not done. Jesus, who died, shall be satisfied, and earth and heaven be one. Let's pray together, shall we? Holy God, we put our eyes on you right now, and we thank you that you are the one who has the words of eternal life. You are the one who has what we need. This morning, with your eyes closed, how many would say, I've been really under a lot of stress and my peace has been really hurting lately? Would you lift your hand just saying, I've been really hurting? Yes, God knows. God knows. God loves. God loves you. Yes. And put him down. Cast your burden upon the Lord, for he will sustain you. Would you carry that burden to Jesus and give it to him right now? Tell him what it is. He knows what it is. You know what it is. He knows what it is. You can't keep secrets on God. He knows. Would you bring him that fear, that worry? Tell him it right now. And then as a believer, as a true follower of Christ in a growing relationship, knowing him in a continuously growing relationship, to say, God, help me to live that way through today. Moment by moment, I'm kept in his love. Moment by moment, I have life from above. Looking to Jesus, till glory does shine. Moment by moment, O Lord, I am thine. I'm yours, Lord. This problem is yours. This situation is yours. I'm yours, Lord. And Lord, I pray you would shine through us in a dark world, that the hope and the light that we have won't just be for ourselves and our own families, but it'll shine to our neighbors and shine to people around who are living in so much fear and darkness. We thank you, Father God, for your peace. You will keep those in perfect peace whose minds are stayed on you. God, thank you for your perfect peace. Thank you, Father, for loving us so much. We surrender to you today. We surrender our hearts to you today. Can you say that to God right now and mean it? God, I surrender my heart to you today. I surrender my heart to you today for whatever you want. Thank you, God. Amen. Let's stand. Let's stay standing.
Deserve the praise, worthy is your name.
learning how to praise God all day long. And if you're not learning it, you're missing out on the peace of God, because that learning how to praise God all day long lifts the burdens and the fears. From not learning how to praise God all day long, the burdens and the fears usually start creeping back in and taking over, don't they? But to live in the presence of God, to make the choice to praise Him through all what's going on and lift it and eyes on Jesus. Since I place my eyes on Jesus, I lose sight of all beside. That's what we want. If you're interested in baptism, I'm going to meet you up front here. Please come up. Otherwise, God bless you. Have a great week. God bless. Get in a group this week. God bless.